On topological susceptibility.
First, I'd like to thank the organizer for giving me this additional opportunity to talk about the result of finite topological susceptibility in finite temperature 2 plus 1 flavor QCD using the gradient flow method. This work is done in collaboration with Yusuke Taniguchi here and Jin Gentry here. QCD collaboration. Gradient flow is an imaginary evaluation of the system into a fictitious time t, but we may view this as a smearing process of a physical range of square root 8t. And it was shown that the operators constructed by flow fields have no ultraviolet divergences nor short distance singularities. Therefore, you can reinterpret this gradient flow as a kind of new physical, it means non-perturbative denormalization scheme, which can be directly calculated on the lattice. And this opens quite a big variety of possibilities to drastically reduce the lattice evaluation of denormalized quantities. And we are applying this gradient flow method to study the finite thermodynamics of 2 plus 1 flavor QCD using the strategy of Suzuki and company. And our result on the equation energy momentum tensor and chiral condensate were already presented by Yusuke in this conference on Monday. And here, I'd like to present our results for the topological charge. In particular, we want to compare two different definitions of the topological charge. One is a gauge definition defined in terms of gluon fields, and other is a fermion definition described in terms of the quark fields. And these two definitions should give equivalent result. However, equivalence have demonstrated with on the lattice with Ginzburg-Wilson type quarks only. And we usually encounter a large discrepancy with non-chiral quarks, such as Wilson type quark that we adopt or symmetric type quark. And for this fermion definition, we derived like that, but I put this on the homepage of this workshop, so you may slowly check at your home. Shall I? So, this is a summary of our simulation parameters. We are studying this system using the denormalization group improved Iwasaki gauge action coupled with non-perturbatively improved global quark action. And we are using the configuration produced in our previous study using the fixed scale approach. So our lattice has only one lattice spacing 0.07. With improved actions, this is rather fine lattice. And also, the S quark is almost at the physical point. But our UD quarks are heavier than the reality. So it's around here. It means some higher mass of about 400 MeV or so. And this is the range of the temperature we study. So we cover the temperature to around 700 MeV. In the fixed scale approach, we vary temperature by varying the temporal extent of the lattice. This is NT. So at the highest temperature, the NT is only 4. And to avoid over-smearing, wrapping around the finite lattice, flow time should be smaller than some value that we call T half. And for the case of this highest temperature, because it is only 4, we reach quite quickly to this limit. But at lower temperatures, we have some range of flow time to be studied. The gradient quark flows, we adopt the simplest ones. For the gain flow, we adopt the standard Wilson flow suggested by the Dirichlet. And for quark flow, we also follow the suggestion of Dirichlet, and we flow using only the gauge dynamics. So this simple flow is shown to keep the most good features of gradient flow by Lucia and Weiss, and except that quark field gets non-trivial denormalization. This requires us to work some additional numerical study measuring these quantities. But that's all. Other quantities, when we do this denormalization, other quantities are all denormalized and all finite. And okay. So let us first discuss about gauge definition. So we define the topological charge using this well-known Blum combination. And for this study, we use the gradient flow just as Cooling steps. So we extract the information of this topological charge and its susceptibility from the data at large T. Yeah. So this is our result of cooling on the zero temperature. So this is the one. And this is a, let's say, snapshot, I don't know, time evolution of the distribution. At first, we have a lot of non-integer result for the topological charge as we usually encounter. But after cooling, they accumulate to integer values. So gradient flow works well as a cooling step. This is a result at zero temperature, and this is result just below the critical temperature. So it works also, and we have sufficient range of topological charge to study with. And this is above the critical temperature, so it's something like that. It becomes narrower, and around TC 1.8, although we still have some range of topological charge, but in the histogram accumulation to the Q equals zero sector is starting. So above this point, the freezing to Q equals zero becomes a problem. Yeah. This is a result for the topological susceptibility as a function of the flow time. So this is a zero temperature result and so on. So for these temperatures, we see a quite flat, good flat behavior. So we can safely extract the result. But for temperatures larger than 0.8 TC, we find that topological susceptibility is still decreasing. And we have stopped this gradient flow at the T half that I mentioned, because we have started this work to study the energy momentum tensor using the gradient flow method. Using the gradient flow method as a kind of denormalization scheme. And for that case, T half is a quite important barrier. But presumably, for the cooling step, we may extend this. And when we go back to Japan, we are planning to extend these topological, so larger values. But for this talk, I have only this result. Therefore, we should regard these results as a kind of upper bound for the susceptibility. And this is our result for the topological charge susceptibility in the gauge definition. As I said, these results here is not saturated. Therefore, we should regard them as a kind of upper bound for the susceptibility. And also, as I said, for temperatures higher than 2 Tc, we may have the problem of freezing to the Q or to zero sector. And also, as Yusuke Taniguchi explained, from the study, our study of energy momentum sensor, we find that the lattice abstract due to the smallness of MT itself becomes large for these 3 points. Therefore, please forget about that. And remaining result for the topological susceptibility. And although the temperature is still quite close to TC, we try to fit the value in the high temperature phase with this scaling concept. And we found that the exponent is quite close to the value predicted by the dilute intensity gas approximation. We do not know the reason why it appears for this small temperature, but this is our. And now I switch to the next determination, Hermion definition. So we study this topological charge susceptibility in terms of this pseudo-scalar density correlation. And in this case, we use the gradient flow as a kind of denormalization scheme and extract the physical information in the limit of vanishing flow time. So this we follow the strategy proposed by Suzuki. And as I said, gradient flow provides us with some kind of physical normalization scheme which can be directly calculated on the lattice. But it can be also calculated with other regularizations. And the results should be independent of the choice of the regularization. And then we may use this finite quantity to relate lattice operators with some operators defined in the continuum scheme. This is quite useful when we are studying observables related to some symmetry which is violated on the lattice, such as the chiral condensate, the energy momentum source, and so on. And here, we define this P0 by a chiral Takahashi identity in the continuum scheme, say, dimensional regularization, and relate it with the lattice scheme, lattice operator through this finite quantity. And but from the evolution in the by the gradient flow, some unwanted operators can mix at finite flow time. And this should be removed to obtain the desired operator. Therefore, we do the extrapolation to T to zero. And then we obtain the this quantity in a flow regularization, gradient flow regularization scheme. And to translate it to more conventional schemes, such as MS-bar, we can use the perturbation theory in the continuum theory. So this is our way of calculation. So this chi, is a flow coefficient. Yeah. And we compute this on the lattice, and do the correction for the Koch field denormalization, and take the continuum limit. T to the zero limit. Then we obtain the physical quantity. This is a matching coefficient between the flow scheme and MS bar scheme computed by this Kieda and Suzuki. This is, in a sense, ideal case. On the lattice, with small but finite lattice spacing, some additional operators can mix because of the dimensionality of the lattice spacing. And in fact, we found that such term can appear on finite lattice up to finite t. And because this is singular at the origin, this may be, this can be an obstacle to this taking this t to zero limit. So ideally, if we can do the continuum extrapolation first, then we can wipe out these things, and we can safely extrapolate to t equal zero. But as I said, we are still doing just one lattice spacing, and we instead extend the order of a to zero and t to zero by removing such term by half. Still, we have some finite contribution at a order a square something like that. Therefore, we need this continuum extrapolation at the end. But we can study already this zero flow time limit on finite lattices. And this is our result of the topological susceptibility obtained by this flow scheme. The result for the temperature and higher temperature and so on. We do see that some singularity presumably caused by this A square over T term. And also deviation from the linear behavior at larger T, presumably almost order of T square. And what we do is that we can still find a window which behaves rather linearly. Therefore, we have our strategy is that we first choose a window region by examining the data itself and study the fit. First, including this term using the data in this window. And we confirm that the coefficient for this term is sufficiently small. Then we extrapolate linearly to the t equal to zero limit for these data. Yeah. Oh. Okay, this is almost the final figure. This is a result collected everything. This red circle is result of the gradient definition that I have shown before. And this black circles are the result of this Fermion definition. And so, you see, as before, we remove these data and believe these things, then we find that most definitions agree quite well at TOTC smaller than 1.5 that we can access with our study. And also, we also tried this exponential exponent fit for this Fermion definition, and we again found the coefficient consistent with the dilute gas, instant gas approximation. So this is the result. So we have applied the gradient flow method to investigate some dynamics of Tsukuba flavor QCD. And the result of equation state and chiral condensate was presented by Yusuke Taniguchi. Here, I present the result of topological susceptibility defined by gauge definition, in which gradient flow is used as a pooling method. And we extract the information from T for large values. And compare it with the topological susceptibility defined by the Feynman definition. And in which gradient flow is used as a kind of generalization scheme. And we extract the physics from the T to zero beginning. And we find that these completely different methods agreed quite well with each other. And somehow strangely, maybe, reproduce the temperature dependence predicted by the derivative instant mass approximation. But before applying these results to, for example, axion cosmology and so on, we should recall that our quark mass is still heavy. So we have to continue the study to write up quark mass. And also, a definite comparison of the two methods is in principle possible only in the after taking the continuum limit. Already we have solved agreement that is suggesting that the lattice spacing of our lattice is maybe already quite small. Anyway, we need to do the continuum preparation too. So, thank you very much.
Thank you. Questions?
Well, I have one question.
Since you use, when you use whistle flow as cooling, whistle flow is the same as cooling in the old days of 2000.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of discussions there.
Yeah.
Which kind of action you should use in order not to falsify the results, because depending on you will have different results.
Yeah.
So I don't have the impression that in connection with whistle flow, the same kind of critical discussion is applied. One just take AT and this is all. I have the impression that in connection with whistle flow, applying whistle flow as cooling, the same kind of critical discussion is not done. Uh-huh. One just take a scale from this actually perturbative estimation of AT score and so on, and it's just all.
Uh-huh.
While the situation actually, if you learn from this cooling analysis, is much more subtle.
Can I ask one?
Yeah.
So, yeah, at low temperature, you have this very nice distribution of the charge. But I wanted to ask you if you've looked at the distribution of the susceptibility as a function of the topological sector when you have this nice distribution. Is it flat?
That we have seen.
Maybe it would be nice to see, because then at high temperature, if it's flat, maybe it's not.
Yeah.
I have a question. So I have a question. So you showed it probably, but I missed it. What values of NT did you use in view of the previous talks that said you have to go to quite large NT?
So
it goes quite large.
Drop these three results and take them.
Oh, but they are fixed. They all have different temperatures, so continuous.
Fixed and scale across the lattice spacing is fixed.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. More questions? Lunch? Let's thank the speaker again.